The religion is the solution for the things happening all around the
jihad
world.
Jihad does not mean any war fought by any Muslim. Jihad basically means to strive to struggle.
The Hindus and the Muslims will be united.
He is not cosmic energy, he is more superior than that. Quran gives you the solution to the problems of humankind. Not that we shall despise each other. That according to Japan, India will be the superpower of the world. We will be a superpower, will be far superior to the Americans.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Al Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa man ahsanu qawlan mimman da'a ila Allah wa amila salihan. Qala innani muslimin. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. May you're most welcome to ask any questions on Islam and comparative religion. Any question which a non-Muslim have asked you and you are unable to reply. Yes, brother.
Hello. Assalamu alaikum, sir.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
The Jews actually use the system of sabah whenever they halal. It's a kind of this thing, sabah. Are we permitted to eat that food?
The brother asked the question that when the Jews do their kind of zabiha, are we allowed to eat the kind of food? The Quran clearly mentions that, as well as the hadith, they do zabiha, it's called as kosher. And it's clearly mentioned in the Quran in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 5, that lawful for you for food are the food of the people of the book. So food which is halal for them is also halal for us. And if we enter and read the Bible, so that's clearly mentioned the same principles as applied in the Quran and the Sunnah is there. So if they call it as kosher, for Muslims allowed. But that does not mean that if any Ahl-e Kitab, any Christian that serves the food becomes halal. If it's a meat, mutton or non-veg food, served by Ahl-e Kitab, if it's not done zabiya or not kosher, it's haram for us. Now if we analyze that, today the modern Jews, many of the modern Jews, they don't do kosher. So we have to first see to it that it's a kosher meat. So best is zabiya done by Muslims, number one. But if you're going to a foreign land where you can't find zabiya meat done by Muslims, the second option which is allowed is kosher done by the Jews. But if it's sold by Ahl-e Kitab, Jews and Christians, which is not kosher, then it's haram for us. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
This is a question posed by a child. That as in Surah Fussilat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, repel evil with goodness and your enemy will become your most intimate friend. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the shaitan is an enemy for man. So is it that if you are good to shaitan, he'll become your intimate friend?
Sister asked a question that the Quranic verse says that repel evil with good. And other places in the Quran it says that shaitan is the avowed enemy. Various places including Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 168. That the avowed enemy to the human beings is the shaitan. So does it mean we have to be good to the shaitan? I say yes. We have to be good to the shaitan. Good means what? You have to dawah to him. Fine. Good means get him on the straight path. See, shaitan is of two types. Allah says in Surah Nas, the last chapter of the Quran, chapter number 114, verse number 126, the last verse it says, Qul a'udhu birabbin nas, malikin nas, ilahin nas, min sharril waswasil khannas allazi yuwaswisu fi sudurin nas min aljinnati wan nas. That among the evil people who whisper and withdraw, the category of the Satan, amongst them there are some who are men and some who are jinns. Amongst them, men and jinn. But the seen shaitan, the one you can see, are the human beings who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the seen satans, and the unseen ones are the jinns. And the head is the iblis, and iblis was the jinn. But there are satans in the human beings. So human being who tries to convince you to do something haram, how do you repel? You be good with him. Tell him robbing is wrong, raping is wrong, don't cheat. That's good. He may think it's not good for him, but actually it's good for him. So even when Satan comes, we have to repel evil with good. Good means speak the truth. Allah says in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 256 that La ikraha fid deen, there is no compulsion in religion, but truth stands out clear from error. So when the Satan comes also, you repel it with good. Don't repel it with evil back. If he's cheating, you don't cheat him. There are parts in the Quran which have given you permission that you can, as Allah says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 126, that if they catch you out, you can catch them out in the same way, but not worse. But best is forgiveness. So there are chances where Allah has given you permission. But the best is repel evil with good. In some cases, you can catch them out same, but cannot do an evil act. That becomes allowed in Islam if they do something wrong to you. You can use that same strategy as long as it's not a haram strategy. But don't go beyond the limits. But the normal general rule is repel evil with good, sister. Even if Satan is there, repel him with good. And inshallah, try and make that Satan a Muslim, inshallah. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any brothers have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brother is a sister from the sister's side. She said about sunnah, whether we can, what is a sin and what is not a sin, as you had explained it before. There is one thing like, you know, removing of the beard. When you have already grown a beard, remove it and then you can grow it again. This is a part of this, what I wanted to ask you at that time. And I have a question relating to this thing, sins and all the thing. When a Hindu says that, I believe in Ishwar, the same way as you believe in Allah. But there are many people in the sect like who believe in Dargah. So I am one of them, part of them. I also believe in Dargah also. I go to the Dargah also. I go to my temple also. What is their concept is that they are having the same thing, the same ideology, like, you know. So how to deal with this kind of thing?
Well, there are two questions. The first question is that suppose you keep a beard, and then if I shave off that beard and then keep a beard again, isn't it a sin? So many people think that, you know, one is to grow a beard and then shaving becomes haram. First, you have to realize that is keeping a beard is part of mustahab. Some scholars say it's a fard because it's a commandment of the Prophet. There's no verse in the Quran saying whether the beard should be kept or not. But Allah says, Ati Rasul, obey Allah and obey the Messenger. It's clearly mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, point number 7, Hadith number 788, 781, that the beloved Prophet said, let your beards grow and trim your moustaches. So those people are very strict who say that anything what the Prophet has commanded and has not done action contrary to it, it becomes fard. So if you are that strict, so this keeping a beard becomes fard. There's another group of scholars who say that if the Prophet has commanded and there's nothing contrary, and along with that, if there is a punishment mentioned for that act, if you don't do, then it becomes a fard. For example, the Prophet said that keep your trousers above the ankle. If the trousers go below the ankle, then that part will burn in hell. There is a punishment mentioned. So the category which is second category, the staunchest category, even if punishment is not mentioned and nothing contrary is there in any of the Sahih Hadith, it becomes fard. So if you belong to the first category of scholars, keeping a beard becomes fard. The second category of scholars say that if the Prophet has commanded and nothing contrary is mentioned, and if you don't follow that commandment, a punishment is mentioned, it becomes fard. So that is keeping the trousers above the ankle. That's the second group of scholars. Third group of scholars which are very lax. They say, unless it is clearly mentioned haram in the Quran, only if Allah says and Prophet says. That is the third group, which is the most lenient. So depending which group of scholars do you follow? Safest is follow the first group, to be the safest. Whatever the Prophet has said, nothing contrary. And try and do as much as possible. But for sure, no one can say that keeping a beard is not mustahab, is not sunnah. It is minimum sunnah, means minimum mustahab. Either fard or mustahab. Two options are there. So if you fall in the category of believing those scholars that keeping a beard is fard, then keeping is fard. Even if you believe in those group of scholars, second or third group, even they agree that keeping a beard is sunnah if they don't say it as fard. But yet, following sunnah is preferable. Now, some people have a different kind of mindset. What they say, if I keep a beard, I'll have to keep it for my full life. Then if I shave it, it's a sin. It's like telling, once I start offering salah, and if I stop offering salah, it's a sin, so I'll not start only offering salah. So many people don't keep a beard. I'll keep a beard, then I'll never shave in my life. So now I'll have to enjoy it. 10 years later, 15 years later, we'll keep it. So this is absolutely nonsense. Absolutely nonsense according to me. That those people are not keeping it because they say that once I keep shaving is a sin. Some people say after I come back from Hajj, then I start keeping. Why? Then we start praying after you come back from Hajj. So this category of people who think that once I start keeping and then if I shave it's a sin. See, keeping is a fard. So even if you keep for 1 year and shave it for 5 days, again keep. Best is never to shave. But that is preferable than not keeping at all. So your question is mainly that if I keep a bit and then if I shave, then it's a sin or not. So if you fall in the category where keeping a beard is a fard, keeping is a fard. If you shave, it becomes a sin, whether if you shave first or second. But if you fall in the category of those who consider that beard is a sunnah, then it's better you at least keep for a few years, even if you shave it for a few days or a few weeks or a few months, yet at least you have done sunnah for that time, for that few years you kept, and again you keep it again. So this is totally illogical to say that once I keep, I should not shave. Or if I shave, it's a sin. If you fall in the category, you believe that keeping a beard is a sunnah, then shaving is not a sin. But I agree with those scholars, at least as far as beard is concerned, that keep it. Even if it's a mustab, it's a very high category of mustab. Sunnahs also have categories. Muqadda, ghayra muqadda. So I consider it to be a very high category. I recommend everyone to keep it. And you should not shave. But if suppose a time comes, you keep it, and then for some reason, if you have to shave also, whether it's fard or sunnah, at least start keeping it today. Tomorrow, if that situation arises after 5 years, where you fall in such a trap where you have to shave, best is not to shave, unless your life is in danger, etc., where Islam gives permission. But if something happens, at least you'll get sawab for that few years which you have kept the beard. So this logic that once I keep, if I shave, it will be a sin is totally wrong. If it's a fard, it's a sin not keeping itself now. You can't say, okay, now if I start offering 5 times salah, there may be a situation 5 years later where I may not be able to offer 1 time salah. So then better not start offering 5 times from now. So this logic will be applied everywhere then. And salah is a bigger fard than beard. So it's best that if you know whether it's fard or mustab, start doing it. When you start, think you'll continue for a lifetime. If God forbid something happens also yet, inshallah, you'll get sawab for the time you have kept. Hope that answers the first part of the question. As for the second part of the question, you said that there are many non-Muslim Hindus who say believe in Ishwar. So how do we answer them? And some say that you go to Dargah, we go to temple, what is the difference? So as far as a non-Muslim or a Hindu says he believes in Ishwar, you have to first try and find out what is the definition of Ishwar. If his definition of Almighty God Ishwar fits in the definition of Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, Qul huwa Allahu ahad, say he is Allah one and only. Allahu samad, Allah the absolute and eternal. Lam yulid wa lam yulad, he begets not nor is begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there is nothing like him. If that definition of Ishwar which he believes in falls in this four line definition of Surah Ikhlas, we have no objection in accepting that person as true Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it doesn't fall, then it's a false Almighty God. As far as those people going to Dargah, see anyone, whether he calls himself by any name, whether he calls himself by Abdullah, Zakir, Muhammad, Sultan, just by giving a Muslim name, a person does not become Muslim. So a person goes and worships anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this shirk. If someone bows down to an idol, it is haram. If he bows down to a dead man, also it's haram. To a living man or to a grave is haram. So if someone does shirk means worships, so if someone goes to Dargah and worships the grave, it is haram. Ask from the grave, it's haram. But someone goes to the grave and does dua for the person, ask for forgiveness for the person who has died from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is fine. So if you go to a grave and ask for maghfirat of the person who has died, maybe your father, your grandfather, great-grandfather, or a person you think is very holy, you can ask for forgiveness for that person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can pray for him, but you can't pray to him. So if you pray to anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that becomes shirk, irrespective of the person doing has a Muslim name or not. The person goes to Dargah and prays to anyone besides Allah, it is shirk. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Writing a script or a play or a skit having more of entertainment and less of message, will that be encouraged in Islam?
The sister has a question that if you write a script or a play which has more of entertainment value, less of Islam, is it allowed? See, best is to write a script in which a person comes closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the best. But if you write a script which has entertainment value, which is not forbidden in Islam, or has entertainment value which is not haram in Islam, it is mubah. Writing that script is also mubah. If all the activities of the play, the script, the actors, the message, if not a single portion, not 0.01 portion of that play comes under haram activity, then that play per se becomes mubah. Mubah means optional. But if you write a script which has an Islamic message, part Islamic, part entertainment, or two in one, that is the best. But even if you write a script which doesn't have any haram element in it, and if you write a script only for entertainment value, that comes under the category of halal entertainment. So if it is a halal entertainment without Islamic message, but not having even 0.001% of haram portion in it, writing such a script becomes mubah, allowed in Islam. But preferable is give an Islamic message. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any brothers have any questions? Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. How do we dawa to the deviate sects in Islam? How do you dawa to them?
Brother has a question that how do you do dawa to the various sects in Islam? Whichever sect is there in Islam, it's clearly mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 103. Wa tasimu bi hablillahi jamia wa la tafarraqu. Hold to the rope of Allah strongly and be not divided. So Allah says, hold to the rope of Allah. The rope of Allah is the glorious Quran. The glorious Quran and the Sahih Hadith. So every Muslim should hold together to the glorious Quran and Sahih Hadith and be not divided. Quran clearly mentions in Surah An'am chapter number 6, verse number 159, that anyone who makes sects in the religion of Islam, O Prophet, you have nothing to do with him. So making sects in Islam is haram. But unfortunately, we have various sects among the Muslim community, various sects. It's clearly mentioned in the Quran several places, making sex is haram. If you analyze, what was the beloved Prophet Muhammad? What was he? He was a Muslim. So all the Muslims should go back to Quran Sunnah. That is the reason the best way to do Islah to a Muslim is whenever you give a reply, quote the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. So once you start giving references, the people will come to know the truth from falsehood. So whenever you give a reply, always follow up with proof along with references. Many of the speakers, they give answers without referring to Quran and Sunnah, without giving references. So when you make it common in the general masses, that whatever answer you give, back it up with proof, with reference and quotation from Quran and Sunnah, there are chances to come back to truthful. And Islam is only one. It's not divided. Though our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's hadith, a Sahih hadith of Tirmidhi, he said that there will be 73 sects in Islam. The Prophet didn't say he should make. There will be. Out of which, only one will go to Jannah. The people ask, which one? He said, those who follow the Prophet and the Sahabas. So, all those who are on the straight path, following Allah and His Rasul, and the beloved Prophet said that, if you do not find in the Quran or in my Sunnah, look in the next generation, the Sahabas. If you don't find there, then look in the next generation. Then the next. That is Sahaba, Tabain, and then Tabi Tabain. So, for example, for any proof or hujah, we look into the Quran. If you don't find the Quran, look into the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, Sahih hadith. If you don't find there, then the lifestyle of the Sahabas, then the Tabain, then the Tabi Tabain. So if you follow this, you're on the true path. Anyone who deviates from this path is not following true Islam. Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. You have just mentioned one hadith which says that there will be 73 sects in Islam. This hadith doesn't mention any time, exactly at what time it will be, whether in the just after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or after 1 century, or a 10th century, or 20th century. It doesn't mention any time, or whether all 73 will be there at a time, or it will be spreaded over till Qiyamah. So my question is, how useful is this hadith to mention or to quote when it doesn't specify anything which is going to help anyway?
The brother has asked a question. That this hadith, that there will be 76, does not specify the time. Will it be together? Will it be in the 12th century or 13th century? I am saying the hadith says there will be. Surely it will be before Qiyamah. Now I am asking the question, even if it specifies, will it make a difference? If the hadith specified, suppose, for sake of argument, there will be 73 sects in the 12th century. Fine. It will continue. So for today, irrespective whether there are 72 sects, or 50 sects, or 30 sects. The Quran says don't make sects. So you should be more interested in following one which is on the straight path, that is Quran and Sunnah. I am not bothered whether there are 72 or 150. Suppose I tell you today there are 53 sects. Will it make a difference to you? So irrespective whether there are two sects today or 73 sects, two sects or 73, your amal remains the same. You have to follow Quran and Sunnah. So what difference does it make? So the message is clear that there will be many sects. 73 is the number put by the Prophet. But even whether it is 50 or it is 30, your rules and guidance remain the same. It does not change. So for us, the message is clear that there will be many sects. You don't have to get involved in the sects. The one who is on the true path is the one who does not make sects. The sect which is on the true path is the one that does not make sects. Who says that? Quran says that. Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 159. So if you tell that the hadith doesn't carry weight, it is illogical. The hadith is sufficient. It is an evergreen hadith. Evergreen means it applied at the time of the Prophet. It will apply today. It will apply till Qiyamah. Because the logic is the same. If you would have mentioned the time, then it may have been time bound. And somebody said, okay, Prophet said 12th century, now in 21st century, it may not be there, it may be there. So the Prophet's hadith is, mashallah, he is much more intelligent than you and me. So what he has said is, alhamdulillah, perfect. It's an evergreen, it can be applied to all times. And irrespective of the life today, or tomorrow, or yesterday, the hadith is applicable. It's telling us to go back to Quran and Sunnah. Follow Allah and His Messenger and the three rightly guided generations. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
This is in reference to the hadith where Prophet said that on the day of Qiyamah, unhorned animal will take its revenge with the animal not having a horn, and then they will become dust. Now, do the animals have the concept of morality or something of oppression kind of? Do they have the choice?
Sister, that's a very good question. That the animals, there are various hadith talking about this. Suppose one animal has wronged the other animal. On the day of judgment, that animal will be made to attack and then they'll go in the dust. Here we realize that, relates to my earlier answer, which I gave, that we human beings are undergoing the test. These animals are already Muslims. They have submitted their will to God. But yet, they have their rules and regulations. But as far as submitting the will to God, they are submitted. But while submitting the will to God, whatever little bit here and there which is allowed in their way of life, if they have wronged some other animal, that hisab kitab will be on day of judgment and then both will become absolutely finished. There is no Jannah and Jahannam for them. It is for the human beings. For us, we are undergoing the test. For the animals, it's not there. That they are already Muslims. They are submitting the will to God. So for them, they'll just pass the test. So that is the reason if while passing the test, if they made certain mistakes, like if they have unnecessarily harmed another animal, that animal will be able to harm him back and then the account will be nil for both and that will be the end of the case. For us, after the day of judgment, depending upon a deed, good or bad, we'll go to heaven or hell. Hope that answers the question, sister. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah bil alamin.
Ya Rabbu innaka antas salam. منك السلام إليك السلام فيا رب إنك أنت السلام منك السلام إليك السلام لأمرك يرجع أمر الأنام بين يديك قلوب الأنام لأمرك يرجع أمر الأنام بين يديك قلوب الأنام.